You're watching Taiwan Plus.
Okay.
We're in the 101.
101. You star, girl, take me to your heart. Your heart, your heart. Girl, take me to your star. I'm gonna make you run. It's just begun. I'm howling at the rising sun.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to today's Taipei Tonight Show. I'm your host, Dennis Nia, coming to you live recorded from the Taipei 101 building studio. Thank you so much for watching our show in the past weeks, but today is a very, very special episode. Now, we have a beautiful stage here, and we like to invite onto this stage some of the new talents here in Taiwan as well. And today, we're very lucky to have one of them. Now, the music industry in Taiwan is very vibrant and very deep. The genre dates back to, you know, 40s, 50s, and 60s, from the Taiwanese folk music all the way to the Mandarin folk songs, and then to Mandarin pop, which led the entire Mandarin world. And now a new stage has begun because of social media, because of digital electronic music production. So a new generation of artists are springing up from all over the place. Today's special guest is one of those. He's got great looks. Man, I hate introducing such handsome young men, but I like this guy. He's very, very talented. Started off as a model, but went into music, and he has been making waves all over the place. His music is loved, and his looks loved as well. Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest today on the Taipei Tonight Show is KIRE!
This is KIRE. That song is called Sun, featuring Sun Sunshine. If you like the song, go check it out on all music platforms. Alright? Hey.
Give me one more flight, head towards sunlight. Never shine so bright, for you lay down my life. 他们小活该, 但我心却更自由, 自在, 痛快, 我愿意为爱。
Maybe just a minute, forever was within it. You don't ever have to say it, my heart.
I know.
这让我们疯癫，不是对我誓言。
Your star, girl, take me to your heart. Your heart, your heart. Girl, take me to your star. Your star, your star. Girl, take me to your heart. Your heart, your heart. Girl, take me to your star.
You're the risk to take, a trash play. A Romeo, how he got played by fate. If I don't stop, I will drop. But that's the only way I don't know love. Now spiraling down, waiting for my judgment. Was it worth the fall? Yeah, I smiled every moment.
Just one touch of your love, burn me
beautiful hot sun.
Yeah, yeah.
Hi! That was awesome.
That's a nice clap.
Oh, have a sit down. Oh man, what a handsome looking young man. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, thank you.
Great music. And I've been hearing a lot about you and your music. I'm seeing it take off. I'm very glad you're here with us here today. But you're Taiwanese, but did you grow up abroad? What's your deal?
So I was born here. And then I was sent to America when I was like eight or nine. And then I came back when I was 19. So I was in America 10 years or so. Wow. Houston, Texas.
Wow, so you're Houston, a Texan.
I'm a Texan, yeah.
Wow.
You don't hear that a lot, actually, so.
When did you make your transition back to Taiwan?
My transition was when I graduated high school.
Okay.
And I knew, like, from little, I wanted to do, like, some, like, entertainment industry. But back then, it was kind of hard to do that in America. Mm-hmm. I think nowadays it's easier because, you know, of K-pop, and you have different, you know, pop stars from Asia. Like, mm-hmm. Back then, it was nobody. Everybody called me, like, Jackie Chan, Jet Li in school. That was my nickname.
Right.
So it's harder to do that in America. So mm-hmm. I always wanted to come back to Taiwan and do some sort of entertainment work.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you got off the plane. He was a model. He was the go-to male guy model for a long time here.
No, actually, I was not. So I'm actually too short to be a model here.
You're too short to be a model?
I'm too short. I'm only like 178 centimeters.
Okay.
You're way taller than me. But I was trying to find some kind of way to go into this industry.
Uh-huh.
So back then, like, there was, like, you know, a lot of famous shows like Xing Guang Da Dao.
Uh-huh.
And that was how you get into this industry.
Yep.
You had to go through some sort of competition.
Contest. Yeah.
And then, like, I think I went to this one modeling competition.
Okay.
And I was the shortest one in there. But I think, like, they actually maybe see some sort of talent within me. So I end up signing with them. But then back then, I didn't make music. I didn't know how to make music. I was just focusing on, like,
won them over with your looks.
No.
When guests set you up like that, we as a host, we have to finish the sentence.
You got
there.
It. No, actually, I used to play a little bit of guitar.
Okay.
And I guess they liked it. But then, like, I didn't know how to make music until I was like 25.
Okay.
But before that, I was going on, like, competition shows. Like, there was a show called, like, 超级接班人.
Okay. And then compete what?
Compete in bands. Like, there was this, you know, dance band, like, you know, sing, like,
oh, like
idol
a,
kind of thing.
Okay.
Yeah. Back, okay. Like, long back then. And,
But you weren't very musically inclined yet.
No, I was not.
But then you were competing for bands.
All right. So the whole
story. So what were you doing up there?
So the whole story is I wanted to become an idol star.
Okay.
When I was little. But it's quite different from what you expect. Because back then I was looking at maybe, you know, Luo Zhixiang and like K-pop stars.
Yeah.
And you would think like, okay, I just need to sign into one of these companies and they'll train me and then I can become that, right? Mm. So in my mind, it was that simple. But coming over here, I was like, oh, it's not like that. Like, I thought everything was pretty easy. I was going up to like record labels and I was telling them, okay.
All right, you won.
Yeah.
Here I am.
Here I am. That's
what do you want?
I was like, can I see your boss? I wanna try out and stuff. And they were like, did you make an appointment? I'm like, I need to make an appointment. There was this one time, like, I Facebook messaged Machi Dago.
Really?
Really?
Okay, you FaceTime Jeff.
I did.
And then?
And then I was like, yo, my name, but back then I was called Eric.
Yeah.
And my name's Eric, and I wanted to try out and stuff. He was like, all right, send me some tapes. I sent him some videos.
Jeff is great. Jeff is, okay, just to get a little context before you continue with your stories. Jeff is one of the first
OG.
Singer, songwriter, rapper, hip hop groups that came to Taiwan called LA Boys. And Jeff was the older brother of the three boys that were in that group. We were very, very good friends. He's a great guy.
Yeah,
and then what happened?
And he never replied me back. And I think 3 years later, I met him Wei Ya.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, yo, man, you never replied me, bro. I was like, yeah, look where you are right now. You're in Yiling. Now I'm in modeling agency company. So, you know, the way I think, I'm very simple-minded. I just, if I want something, I'll do it.
Okay.
But, yeah, I'm just a little bit naive.
That's great. Well, it takes a little bit of that to be in show business. And look at where you are now. You're making music. By the way, I love your music.
Thank you so much.
It's great. So at some point, you said, oh, I got it. If it's not happening to me, I'm gonna make it happen for me.
Yeah. So,
right?
So back then I would, you know, think the company would have to invest in you, right? But I think my company didn't have the funds to do that. So I was like, okay, I'll try to learn this thing, and then maybe you guys can fund it later if you guys like it. And I just went on YouTube, like, how to produce music and how to make music. I think, like, I started learning how to make music with my laptop, and I just started from there and, you know, making tracks and stuff. And yeah, I spent quite some time by myself in a room just make how to arrange, record, mix, simple demos and stuff.
Yeah, great. Well, I'm very glad, you know, all these things are falling in place for you,
or
you made it happen for yourself, which is even better, actually, in my opinion. And then you got huge following here in Taiwan already, and then it's starting to spread outside of Taiwan. I really wanted this opportunity to bring you to the stage to let people know what you're all about.
Yeah.
And I understand recently you have this you met a friend and then you're doing a collaboration. What's that all about?
This guy named Kevin, which he runs Sony right now. He's like, yeah, you could meet up with Jaguar. Her name is Jaguar, and he goes, y'all could write. So I messaged Jaguar, and yeah, we just hit it off. And she came over to my house, and we wrote a song, and yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I really feel like I'm talking to my son here. she's really dope, and y'all should get together and, write some songs.
Yeah, our vocabulary is very limited.
And you guys did that. And then, it just happened that while we're recording this episode today, she is in Taiwan right now, right? So. Yeah. We invited her onto the show and she said yes, so let's welcome Jaguar! Well, welcome to Taiwan!
No, thank you so much for having me.
And you're not just visiting, you're part of Taiwan.
Yeah, yep. Right? So mom is Taiwanese.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then, so were you, have you been here before?
I have been here before. This is my third trip this year, but I've been here, a handful of times before this year. I definitely have a strong connection to Taiwan. I was raised by my Taiwanese mother. There's the Taiwanese culture, Taiwanese discipline, so I feel like, the food and everything, I very much feel connected to it. And I got my Taiwanese passport this year.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Oh, congratulations! Wow!
Yeah. Pay them taxes, baby.
In two countries now.
That's wonderful. And then, but you grew up in a number of different places.
So I was born in Japan.
Okay.
Yeah, I was born in Japan. And then I moved to Australia when I was nearly seven. Mm-hmm. I had a very turbulent childhood, and I definitely grew up in many different homes just due to complicated reasons. Mm-hmm. I'm a melting pot of many different cultures and experiences, and I feel like that's what led me to become a musician.
That is awesome.
An artist.
And then, congratulations on all your successes in the music industry. You're making quite some waves in Australia, and then in the States as well. Now you are looking at Taiwan a little bit more.
Yeah.
That's great. So how did you? I mean, we just got a little clip of.
Yeah.
How he started this music career. I mean, what about you?
Well, we're actually really similar, I feel, right?
We're all similar then.
Yeah, yeah, I feel like we're really similar.
One big
family.
One big family. So I didn't really grow up doing music or creativity. I was, I studied engineering, I studied business, I became a business analyst. I didn't really think that I wanted to be a musician, or I'm also a visual artist and
you
do
were
a lot
an
of creative
analyst
stuff.
Before a musician.
Yeah, I worked in software development.
Really? And your fashion sense back then was a similar to?
I would say it was strictly corporate, kind of what you're wearing, but different color maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, maybe
wear this?
Yeah, would you wear this? You can borrow my top.
You have to see my personal closet. This is not what I usually wear, all right? I should have came in my own clothes today.
I thought you would have seven suits, one for Monday, Tuesday.
Oh,
Wednesday.
Yeah.
But I love this, your style, your fashion, your looks, and then also music as well. All right, so then how did you always have an interest in music or what?
No, not at all. Because I had a really difficult childhood and adolescence, I then my really close friend passed away when I was 18. And I think that was when everything bubbled up to the surface. And I felt like I need to have it spill out, but I didn't know how. And at the time, I didn't really have a support network where I could talk and find that safe place. So I actually ended up like walking past a garage sale and I decided to buy a guitar and I was like, I'm gonna learn how to play the guitar, but I didn't. I just started writing terrible music, but it was my like genuine feelings that I'd never like shared before, and I fell in love with that process. And I knew then that I had found passion in my life. And up until then, it was just like survival. But once I found passion, I was like, I need to enjoy my life. And I can't live without this passion. So I decided then and there that I was gonna flip my life 180 and make that, you know, a dominant part of my life.
Wow, yeah. That is wonderful. Yeah, you know, I normally don't get this serious on this show, but I have to make a comment. I've read some of your information that you're growing up. You did face a number of challenges. For those of you watching, you look it up. The story is out there. But then you've been so strong. You've overcome these challenges, and then you've been so positive. You feel that the vibe that you're sending out, the attitude that you're, it's such a good role model for many young people
Thank
out there.
You know? I think it's super important because otherwise there's no meaning to my life, right? So like through every difficult situation, I need to find a positive outcome.
Mm-hmm.
And life is difficult. Like, you know, life is difficult for everyone. And so I just feel like it's really important to go like, what can I get out of this? Mm-hmm. And how can I pass that on to someone else? And that's kind of my driving passion and finding resilience through every difficult situation is like, can I help someone else? Because it's something that I probably wanted,
yeah,
but I didn't have. And so I am driven very much by how I can make a change, even if it's in my little world. Yeah.
And then how, I understand that you do feel quite connected to Taiwan as well.
Yeah.
Half of you is from here. How familiar are you with Taiwan? And you know, what
pretty familiar, I think.
And you speak Mandarin. You
know, Yi dian dian.
Hey, there you go. That's one of the first things you learn about Taiwanese. Yi dian dian, right? You got to get that in there. Okay. So when you guys finally met up, what was the first impression of you know, seeing this good-looking kid in front of you?
What a pretty boy.
I mean, did you guys hit it off?
Or... Yeah, we did. I feel like we have a really similar like upbringing, mentality.
Yeah.
I think we drive a lot of our projects. You know, a lot of artists have a big team around them, while we are very much DIY people. We will, you know, learn everything to get things done, make our dreams come true. You know, just like you kind of lock yourself in a room and learn production, I will take what I can get and stretch it out to try and accomplish my vision. So
I think what's interesting is like people would think like, you know, me meeting with Jaguar, like we would just write music.
Mm.
But usually like half the time or most of the time, we're just talking about life.
Yeah.
And getting to know each other. And then from there, we just start, okay, so maybe what can we write about? And what can we do?
If this is amazing. So you guys all started quite well into your adulthood. And then, but you decided, I want to do music. And you got into it and you taught yourself through whatever information you could find out there. I mean, what is the music industry like nowadays?
So nowadays, a lot of kids, they just go on YouTube, type in like, what kind of type beat do you want?
Type beat.
Type beat, like T-Y-P-E, okay. E, and B-E-A-T. And you can just write, okay, I want The Weeknd type beat, or Bruno Mars type beat.
Oh.
And you can find, you know, instrumental tracks that are similar to that kind of sound.
Okay.
And then they just grab the track, they write melody line over it, and then they have someone to rearrange the track.
Show us.
So this is kind of lo-fi hip-hop kind of thing.
All right, so this is something we can find.
Something you can find on the internet.
All right.
Okay, so you can be like, hey, how you feeling now? I'm on this show with Dennis now. I'm chilling Dennis now. So from there, we have a lot of writers in the room, right? And you could drop some beat. You could make some melodies.
Ah.
Hey, come on, yay. And come on, Dennis, yeah.
You're watching TaiwanPlus.
Okay.
We're in the 101.
101. Yeah. And then we just start building, like, we have all these different melody lines, and then you can sing it. Maybe try to find a key. Na 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 na.
Bada ba ba. Na 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 na. Da da da. One and one a time, one a him, one another na. It's all the time, one a pen, one a run and na. Again and again, one a pen, one a five, five, a little, one a more, a ten, a more, a down a five.
Hey, I have to say that line. It's a Mandarin called. Let's give him a big round of applause. Wow.
So that's how people write songs now. That's the easiest way to, you know, to reduce time. Like, sometimes we have music songwriting camps, and everybody would just like bring like 10 tracks, and we would write 3 tracks or so during that day, record it, and then ready for to sell to other people. So that was my job for like the past 3 years.
That's so wonderful. I'm so glad you guys are here today. The vibe. The stories, and then how you guys are going at it, because there's a lot of young people out there that's still looking for directions, and then how does it work?
Just never know.
But anyway, I love talking to you guys. Please come back. Look forward to the collaboration that you guys are doing. But you are here, so I'm not going to let you go without performing something for us. You got a song for us today?
Definitely.
All right, great. Let's do this. Let's do this.
Yay!
Baby, please give me a taste. I'm gonna push and pull.